Honorable dignitaries on the dais and dear friends, Namaskar. At the outset, I would thank the Jammu and Kashmir Study Center Hyderabad and Social Cause for providing me this opportunity to represent the voice today of the lesser known and often forgotten community of Kashmir, the Kashmiri Hindus, Kashmiri Pandits as we generally are known as. So whenever we talk about the Kashmir problem, the issues of Kashmir, the whole focus has always been on the Kashmiri speaking Muslims of the state who are concentrated in a handful of districts in Jammu and Kashmir, in Kashmir Valley in particular. And ever since our independence, successive governments at the center have always dealt with this minority or with this Kashmiri speaking Muslims in a very standard way. Whenever there is issue, just lease out some more doles to the Kashmir Valley. And today I won't go into the accession of Jammu and Kashmir into India, but just as we have been talking about Article 370, we need to just recall that Article 370 was introduced as a temporary measure in the Indian Constitution. And at that time, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru himself believed that it is supposed to erode on its own. Alas, Pandit Nehru does not seem to have had the foresight of the troubles, of the issues he is leading the country into. And leading his example ever since, the government at the drop of hat, or whenever there is any hint of trouble in Kashmir, reacts in the standard way, as I just said. It's about appeasement policy. That's the policy that is being followed for last 60 years and continues to be followed. And by keeping Jammu and Kashmir in this special status of Article 370 and giving it an exclusive state and throwing out sops at the whims and fancies of troublemongers, the problems in Kashmir have only escalated exponentially in these last few decades. And whenever there is trouble, as whatever I little Telugu I could understand, as sir said, that they form a committee. And there are so many committees that have been formed in past. And each committee comes back with recommendations which are very similar in nature. Just add a little more concessions to the Kashmir Valley. And by adding all these concessions and keeping this exclusivity around Jammu and Kashmir, they are only alienating Jammu and Kashmir further away from India. And a similar interlocutor committee was formed when stone pelting incidents were on the rise in Kashmir. But this time, I had a very thin ray of hope from this committee. And I had that hope because I had the chance of meeting these interlocutors in New Delhi in 2010. And when we arrived at the meeting place, strangely only Dilip Padgaonkar actually attended the meeting. It was a 30-minute cordial discussion with Dilip Padgaonkar. And for most part of that 30 minutes, he was the one who was speaking. And he also spoke all the things that we would have anyways told him. So it came out as if he clearly understood the problems of Kashmiri Hindus. I am focusing more on Kashmiri Hindu aspect for my talk. So he came across as a person who seems to have understood the issues of Kashmiri Pandits. He was very empathetic about the atrocities that have been committed on Kashmiri Hindus, especially around 1989 and post that. It gave us a glimmer of hope. So I came out of that meeting, I was a little confused because I knew how these committees behave. But this guy actually spoke from heart. We felt like that. And he even said that he will meet us again and discuss our geopolitical demand that we had raised about Panan Kashmir. So he said he will come back and we will discuss how that can be realized. And unfortunately, that meeting never happened. But we did get a chance to meet talk to the interlocutors once more, and this was in a global teleconference call. So as you all know that in 1989-90, the community of Kashmiri Hindus, the Kashmiri Pandits, were forced into exile from their own roots, from their own homeland, and have since been sort of scattered across the world. Now that's a difficulty for us because we are not able to get together. We have like small pockets of few people here, few people there. So we try to use technology to bridge this gap of physical distances, and accordingly we had scheduled a conference call with the interlocutors with the view that we will present to him our views, our issues, and hope to sort of, when he comes out with the recommendations, he would address our issues. And in that conference call, Dilip Padkamkar opened his note introducing himself, and he gave the same empathy-laden views that he had given us earlier. So I just want to quote from what Dilip Padkamkar said in that meeting. Quote, "For me, the key really to bringing durable peace in Jammu and Kashmir is the fate of the Kashmiri Pandit community. This is because even before I became an interlocutor, in the articles I wrote in the Times of India and in all my public pronouncements on television, I have drawn attention continuously to the plight that the Kashmiri Pandits have faced. The fact that enough attention was not given to them either by the media or by the established political parties was a matter of immense sorrow and concern to me. I therefore feel that you cannot get a durable political solution in Jammu and Kashmir." Please note this. "You cannot get a durable political solution in Jammu and Kashmir until the Kashmiri Pandits are able to lead a life of peace, of harmony, of dignity, of honor, of safety in their own homeland." So naturally, when we hear these kind of words, our expectations go up from this report. And we were hopeful that at a bare minimum, at least he will mention our issues. He may not be able to solve all the problems with a magic wand, but at least he will give due consideration to our issues. And then the report comes out. There were a lot of talks before the report came out, but we just kept our fingers crossed. And many of you, at least few of you, would have read this 179-page report. And if you go through this whole report, there is only a fleeting and insensitive references to Kashmiri Pandits. While pages and pages have been spent on how Kashmiri Muslims are feeling alienated from India, and how there is a need for confidence-building measures to stop that alienation from India, when it comes to Kashmiri Pandits, there's a single line. The line says, Kashmiri Pandits should be encouraged to go back to the valley. Now, how do we get that? There's no recommendation on that. And what about, is the Kashmiri Pandit community also an aggrieved community? Do they also deserve some kind of confidence-building measures? There's complete silence in that whole report. The report goes on and on about missing terrorists. Report talks about the victims of stone pelting. Report says that anybody, any army person who is accused of any kind of wrongdoing should be immediately punished. There should be expedited the whole process of inquiry against him. And we should show that we are duly concerned about those people and we should punish the guilty. I want to ask, who killed Kashmiri Pandits? Who tortured Kashmiri Pandits in 1989-90? Who killed Pandit Taklal Taplu? Who raped Srimati Sarla Ganju? Who killed Pandit Sarvanand Kol Premi by torturing him, actually peeling off his skin where he used to apply the tilak? Who killed him and his son using cigarette butts? Who cut Srimati Girija Tikku into pieces using a carpenter's saw? Who is responsible for the carnages of Chhattisinghpura, of Vandhama? There has been nobody held guilty for all of these crimes. And the report completely ignores all of this as if nothing of that sort happened. It feels as if they seem to agree to the lies that have been spread in Kashmir Valley, saying that Kashmiri Pandits left Kashmir because the then governor, Sri Jagmohanji, asked them to leave. Many times when this question comes to me, I discuss with my friends, I say that if Sri Jagmohan was able to, just by his talks, ask a whole community to leave their homeland, God knows for how long, I would not consider him anything less than Sri Krishna himself. No one community can, just based on somebody's words, just leave. And what happened to those people who were actually killed? Even if they are 206, as per the government records, they are just 206. More than 35,000 people died, but government records that as 206. I'm saying, even if those are 206, who killed those 206? Is there one person who has been held accountable for that? No. So the report completely ignores that, making it amply clear that they are also following the same policy of one-sided appeasement. Now, how far have they gone in that approach also? Let's look at that also. How far have they gone in this approach of appeasement? And this is for the first time in an official report that somebody mentions Pakistan-occupied Kashmir as Pakistan-administered Jammu and Kashmir. even going on to call it Azad Jammu and Kashmir. Wow. If they are Azad Jammu and Kashmir, who are we? And mentioning these terms, using these terms in an official report, amounts to endorsing the blatant lies of Pakistan as far as these occupied territories is concerned. It's like playing into their hands. But what else can you expect from a committee whose whose members have been known to enjoy the hospitality of Ghulam Nabi Phai? And we all along knew that this Ghulam Nabi Phai was a Pakistan agent, and United States government proved that. Now, even after, in the first place, they shouldn't have been appointed the interlocutors for Kashmir, knowing that they were attending these conferences. And after it was proved that Ghulam Nabi Phai was a Pakistan agent, at that time, at least this committee should have been scrapped. At least those two members should have been taken out. But the government of India in itself wanted them to be the interlocutors, wanted the report in that fashion. Has anybody from Kashmir actually accepted the report? Even separatists have rejected the report. Now, if all that they claim that they met so many people and based on their inputs they have created the report, why is there no one single person who is accepting the report? So that means whoever said, they already knew what they are going to write in the report. And they go on, they even as sir also talked about Article 370, they said, let's make it permanent. Let's make it permanent because we want to solve the alienation of Kashmiri Muslims from India. Now, this is for the first time I'm hearing that if two people are alienated, let's keep them exclusive to build the bond. Now, I don't understand that. That's beyond me. Lot of us are in corporate world, are in businesses, are in media. We do create teams for some smaller projects. We go at great lengths to ensure that this team bonds together. We go at great lengths that even after work, they know each other. They understand each other from close quarters. Even if it's a sports team, they are encouraged to be together to build the bond. This is the first time I'm hearing that exclusivity is going to solve alienation. And this report has many other things. I'm sure Dr. Jitendra Singh will also sort of go into the details of those additional things that all the recommendations are dangerous. They talk about no new union law should be applicable to Jammu and Kashmir unless the Jammu and Kashmir Assembly agrees to it. All previous laws should also be opened again and reviewed. Even open trade, this is one thing that always happens within. Whenever they talk about Jammu and Kashmir, first thing that comes to mind is open trade routes with Pakistan. As if the business in Jammu and Kashmir is starving, they don't get a market. They have the whole of India as market. You can see them everywhere in India. What is this hurry and what is this need for opening these trade routes at the back end? At any drop of hat, they talk about this. And tomorrow, if another 26/11 happens, what do we do with those trade routes that we have opened? Nobody seems to think about that. And anyways, I would sort of focus back on Kashmiri Pandit issues. And the other issue that sort of really killed me in that report was, they said that the role of Kashmiri Pandit women is to be encouraged for this rebuilding of ties with Kashmiri Muslims. How come these Kashmiri Pandit women suddenly come into picture? This is like when we were in Kashmir, I don't know how many of you know, this was a normal slogan those days. They used to say, I'll speak in Kashmiri and then translate it. They used to say, as guess Kashmir, but a roast the batin of San, which means we want Kashmir without the male Hindu members and with their female Hindu members. Now, this was after with that context, this was really a killing statement for me in that report. And from the perspective of Kashmiri Pandits in general and Panun Kashmir in particular, we completely condemn this report and we reject this report, categorically reject this report. We were led to believe that there might be some light at the end of tunnel. But unfortunately, even after 60 years, the government of India doesn't seem to have learned the mistakes. And I don't think they even intend to do that. And that leaves the onus on common citizens like us who have gathered today to keep our ears and eyes open and build pressure on the government to ensure that we keep them honest and to ensure them that they don't lead us into a track where ultimately, which leads to the breakdown of the dream that we all have dreamed together, the dream called India. I hope that we don't break that down. Thank you so much.